It's a little bit like Pascal's triangle, or it's in that kind of similar vein where we're going to have these rows of numbers and each row depends on what happened in the previous. In the first row, I just write 1, 1. Then for the next row, every time an adjacent pair of numbers adds up to 2, I'm going to insert that in between them. So I'm going to take a 2 and kind of put it in between those 2 ones. And so for the third row, every time 2 numbers add up to 3 and they're next to each other, I'll insert that 3. So this will look like 1. Because 1 plus 2 is 3, I insert a 3 in there. I keep that 2. 2 plus 1 is 3. So I insert a 3 in there, and then I keep that 1. So each one, it has all of the numbers from the previous sequence. We're just inserting n for the nth row at various points. So for the next one, I insert a 4 whenever adjacent numbers add to 4. So I'll have 1, insert the 4 before the 3, and we'll kind of go through. The only other spot to insert is between that other 3. So I have the 2, I have the 3, insert a 4, and then a 1. I'll keep going for a couple more rows just to see it. Between the 1 and the 4, I'm going to have to insert a 5, but also between the 2s and the 3s, I'm going to have to insert a 5. So I'll take 1, 5, and then 4, 3, 5. Keep that 2. Another 5, 3, 4, insert my last 5, and then a 1. For good measure, I'll just do one more. Between the 1 and the 5, that adds up to 6. None of the next adjacent ones seem to add up to 6, so the only other one I have to add is at the end. So this grows by a smaller amount. Now, someone comes along and they're just asking questions about this. What are the patterns I can observe in this Pascal-esque pyramid? And if they just count how many elements are there in each row, they'd say this one has 2 numbers in its row. This one has 3 numbers. This one here has 5 numbers, 7, 11, 13. And so you're compelled to ask, okay, how is this?
Prime numbers.
Yeah, and you know, I could say, is there any reason that we should expect prime numbers from this? You know, this is just a completely random tower. You know, is there any reason we might expect prime numbers? And I could say, actually, this isn't as random a tower as you might think. It's related to these things called fairy sequences, where if I want to write out what are all of the rational numbers where the biggest possible denominator is 1, that sits somewhere in the interval from 0 to 1, there's really only 2 rational numbers available. I can have 0, which I could write as 0 over 1, or 1, which is 1 over 1. And if I say, okay, what are all the rational numbers in that interval, you know, kind of the unit interval from 0 up to 1, with a denominator that is at most 2? And you could say, well, I've got those 2 that I already had, but I now could also include 1/2 into those. And so, you know, kind of mark a half. And what if we allow the denominator to get as big as 3? And you say, well, in that case, I can have all of the ones that I previously had, but also 1/3 is available, and 1/2, and also 2/3 is available. And I'm writing them in the order that they would show up on the number line, so I'm kind of sorting them from least to biggest. You can show, actually, that this sequence here of this fairy sequence, all of the rational numbers maximized by a certain denominator, is exactly the same as what we were doing up here. All of the denominators on the bottom correspond to one of the rows up here. And there's a kind of cute reason for it. Or when you have a sequence of 3 different rational numbers in this fairy sequence, so I'll just do one more row to kind of see, like, where does 1/4 or the fourths fit in? We've got 0 over 1, a 1/4 is going to fit in here between that and 1/3, then we've got 1/2, then 1/3, and then 3/4 comes up there, and then 1. If we just look at 3 adjacent elements, so maybe I take these here. Note, if I add up the numerators of the 2 on the outside, and then if I add up the denominators also, so I add up the 2 and the 4, 2 plus 4, and I make a fraction out of those, in this case that's the same as 4/6, which is the same as 2/3. This way of combining rational numbers, where I add the numerators and add the denominator, has a fancy name. It's called the mediant. It's kind of like what someone who hasn't yet learned about fractions might think you do when you're supposed to add 2 fractions. It's not a wholly useless operation. It always gives you something that's between those 2. And in fact, in these fairy sequences, it'll always be the case that the mediant of 2 that are offset gives you the one that sits in between. You can kind of see the connection between this and the pyramid, because you need the denominators to add up. So every time you're squishing in, you say, hey, I'm going to introduce the possibility that 5 is a denominator. The only way that that could happen is if its 2 neighbors had denominators that added up to 5. So you look in the previous sequence that corresponds to all the previous rational numbers, and you say, hey, when are those 2 denominators going to add up to 5? That's where I need to insert 1. But it looks so much pure and pristine when we have this pyramid, and I don't mention that it's related to rational numbers. So you might say, oh, it's kind of a natural object. And if you think hard about when do certain rational numbers come up, the amount that you're adding has a lot to do with the number of factors of that. For example, this next time when I'm adding 1/5, I actually know we're going to get a lot more numbers because 5, we have to add 1/5, 2/5, 3/5, 4/5. None of those reduce. Whereas when I add 6, it's not that we're going to add 1/6, 2/6, 3/6, 4/6, because 2/6 is already accounted for. 3/6 is always accounted for. So there's some, you know, loose connection to the idea of how divisible is the next number and things like that.
Priminess is in there.
The priminess is in there, right? Yeah. So we might expect.
So the million-dollar question.
Yeah.
Does this thing keep spitting out prime numbers?
Sadly, the pattern actually breaks. And there's a little hint to when it breaks, too. So I'll do a couple more rows. We should expect that we need to insert numbers corresponding to 1/7, 2/7, 3/7, 4/7. All of these, because none of these fractions reduce, I'm expecting...
So you're using what we learned there to help guide you here now.
I know that I'm going to be inserting 6 different 7s, basically. And so this is now interesting. We count. How many are there? We've got, we should know, it's going to be 13 plus 6. So on the one hand, the pattern continues. But on the other hand, you know, there's a little chink in the armor because 17 is sitting here just kind of wondering why it's been left out of the club.
Yeah, this is a worrying sign.
It's a worrying sign, but it does actually continue. The faster way to do this, rather than inserting them all like this, I can now ask, you know, how many eighths are we going to be adding? How many reduced fractions are there with an 8? And the reduced fractions with 8 are basically just all the odd numbers. So there's 4 that I should be adding. So yeah. I kind of know that the next one is going to get me to 23, regardless of how many I insert in there. And then 9, similar. So 1/9, 2/9, 3/9 is not reduced, but 4/9, 5/9, 6/9 is reduced, so I won't include it. 7/9 and 8/9. People who are curious, the number that we're counting here, all of the basically numerators that don't share any divisors with a denominator would be called the Euler-Totient function of your number 9. And that's basically counting how many numbers are there like this. Numbers less than 9 that don't share any factors with it. So here we know that we would be adding 6, and that gets us to 29, which again, feels pretty good.
Yeah.
And then in terms of 10, you know, the Euler-Totient function of 10, saying, hey, how many numbers up to 10 don't share any factors with it? It's actually only 4. You can see this with 1/10. 2/10 isn't good. 3/10 is good. 4/10, no good. 5/10, no good. 6/10, no good. All of those reduce. 7/10 and 9/10. These, I mean, you can kind of know this because these are the last digits you would expect of prime numbers. All the other, there's only 4 digits available. So if we add 4 to this, that's when it properly breaks.
It broke.
Yeah.
It properly broke.
Properly broke. And in this case, you know, in our previous example, we could do a little bit of analysis to say, oh, well, you know, it was necessarily indivisible by 2, 3, and 5. So there was a good reason. As far as I can tell, this is just a meaningless coincidence. This is a good example of Richard Guy's strong law of small numbers, because as we go through these first few numbers, we can have a little bit of a sense that there's a likelihood they'd coincide with primes, because it starts with 2, and then you add 1 to it, and thereafter you're always adding an even number. So you're either, you know, typically adding a 2 or a 4, or maybe a 6 in there, and so you're getting things that are odd. And so if you think of it as a probabilistic process, you're kind of guaranteed not to hit any even numbers, so that gives you a little something. And when the numbers are so small, if you're an odd number, you know, it's not guaranteed that you're prime, but it's more likely. It's like 50% more likely you will be.
So we're playing around in this part of the number line where the primes are still pretty dense.
Exactly, yeah. And so you're likely to see these sorts of patterns that they just don't hold that long. There's plenty of things like this, actually, where I think when we do pencil and paper intuition building, it's common to just deal with smaller numbers. And, you know, the thing that someone might want to take away is understand, is there a way that small numbers are not representative of the larger numbers? And for instance, how many primes are there between 0 and 100? It's about 25% of them. That's a very atypical part of the number line, right? Because you go out to any other part and it's many fewer that are there.
It's like if you watch Hollywood movies, you would think everyone on Earth is really good looking.
Exactly. Yeah. So if prime numbers are like the sexiest numbers available, right? That part of the number line right towards the beginning, that is your A-list actor group, right? And even if you're in your triple digit numbers, that's like your B-list actor group. Still not representative. And so it can be good to form conjectures, but unless there's an actual reason, I mean, the vague connection, I'm like, oh, something primey is happening here because we're counting number of divisors. you know, you'd want something like that to have some teeth to it. Even before you attempt a proof, you sort of want to believe that the pattern is true and that there might be a reason for it, because that informs how you might pursue that proof and what tactics and properties you would want to isolate.
Presumably there are some patterns and things that can hold for a very, very long time. They're quite dangerous.
Yes, yes. There is another prime number related pattern that takes quite a bit longer to break.
And you guessed it, we're going to show that to you in the third and final video of this little trilogy with Grant Sanderson. All the links to the videos are down in the description, along with links to Grant's own A-list mathematics channel, 3Blue1Brown. You can also check out a podcast we recorded with Grant. There'll be a link down in the description, plus more videos with him and all sorts of other stuff you might like to watch.